Welcome back to Betty. I'm your host, Cynthia Thompson. And do I have a treat for all you fellas out there today? I have a young man with me that has done so many things in the media. I can't even list them all. Why don't I just introduce him and let him tell us all about that?
What would you like to know, Cynthia?
Yes.
I guess, well, I'm Neil Bailey. Last 12 years, I've been a motorcycle journalist. And I think we're talking a little bit about this. And I guess the Reader's Digest version of my career would be I test motorcycles and then report on it. So you could read about it in a magazine, watch a video, or watch television.
Now, I understand, Neil, that you have a television show that's coming on a major cable network. Let's talk about that a little bit.
Well, I do. Part of my job has been testing motorcycles, riding motorcycles around the world. And a number of years ago, I created a television show called Tripping on Two Wheels. And I went with a car celebrity guy on speed. And he and I and his son took off, and we rode around the world and made a travel show. And fabulous fun, really enjoyed it. People got a good kick out of the show, and it went away. Ran 6 episodes, and then that was the end. And at that time, I had gone to Peru and started work with a foundation. Well, I actually started my own foundation, raising money for abandoned kids down there. And so with no TV show going, working in Peru, I thought, why don't I make a TV show about motorcycling that could go to Peru and help the kids? And that's what Neil Bailey Rides Peru, my new TV show, which will be airing on Speed June the 9th. It's what it's called, and that's what it's about.
You know, Neil, let's start at the beginning. How did you start riding motorcycles?
I was passionate about motorcycles since I was about 14 years old. And as soon as I turned 16, I got a small bike. We call them mopeds. I don't know if you have, I think you have them in this country.
Yes.
That was all you were allowed to ride at 16. I wasn't a drunk who didn't have a driving license. it was just all I was allowed to ride at 16. And then when I turned 17, I got a motorcycle, and I have ridden motorcycles ever since. I've had periods of time where I didn't ride, if I was in hospital having surgeries or getting some artificial parts put in. But other than that, I've always been riding motorcycles, and that's been now 35 years.
Now, you mentioned that you have this television show on the Speed Network. What is this show all about? Just you testing motorcycles?
No, the show's called Neil Bailey Rides Peru, and it's reality television with a heart. And what we do is we take 3 average riders, and they have to qualify to come on the show. We put them through some pretty vigorous training on dirt bikes and off-road bikes, and I could sort of, if I can tell you what the outcome of the show is now, they all did very well. They got through the training, and then we took them to Peru. We put them through a life-changing adventure. So we rode across deserts and high mountains at 14,500 feet, and we immersed them in the culture and just the wildness of Peru. And then at the end, we take them to the orphanage that I support, and we had a project for them to do there. One of the riders was a doctor lady, so she did some medical stuff with the kids. And then the guys that were with me assisted on a project where we rebuilt the bakery. So I had a team of volunteers that worked for my foundation. They went on ahead to the orphanage, and they started stripping and working on the bakery. And then when my riders came in, we put them to work for the day.
You know, you mentioned that this is going to air in June, so will you be doing another series where you go to another country and do the same thing in another orphanage with another group of people?
Yes, that's my hope and goal. This is a pilot series. It's 3 1-hour episodes that will air on Speed Sunday nights, 9 o'clock. And in that 3 hours, you get introduced to the cast. You know, we go and look at a bit of their lives, who they are, what they do. We have a doctor, we have an entrepreneur, and we have an ordained minister. And so we meet them, we meet their families, and their reasons for coming on this adventure of a lifetime. Then you watch them training and getting ready and preparing, and then you see them, and you see their story unfold across Peru, and you see their challenge. And there's some very challenging moments on the show. It's up in the Andes Mountains. We're riding at 14,500 feet above sea level. The fog came in, it was freezing fog. You probably couldn't see from here to the other side of the room. We had some crashes. There's a few things happened, which I'm not gonna spoil for the show. Everybody made it. I think everybody gets tested. in their own way. And I think for James, our ordained minister, he's traveled in Africa, he's from the Bahamas, and he's traveled in the third world before. So culturally, it wasn't a big shock for him to see poverty and the way people mm-hmm. live. Physically, he was in his 40s and, you know, sort of getting to that point in life is saying, am I slowing down or what am I doing? And he had to ramp it back up and train and get fit and get ready and learn to ride. So his journey was different to, say, somebody like Troy. He's an IT entrepreneur who's never left the country. So it was his first time in the third world and seeing the way people live and seeing the conditions and the way the traffic systems work. So it was a big eye-opener for him. So everybody's journey is different. Laura, the doctor, she's turning 50 and wanted to do something different. So she's an amazingly tough lady and very driven and very talented. So she has not ridden motorcycles terribly long, but she jumped on the challenge and she trained every weekend.
You have to train?
Yeah, she trained in the gym and she trained on the dirt bike. And yeah, she had to get her skills to a level where she could be able to ride across Peru. Because, as I say, they're average riders and it's very demanding to ride in countries like that.
I bet so. I know this show sounds so exciting. And I know, like, I have a television show and I have a crew of people. About how many people did you have to help you tape all of this?
We had to put 19 people in and out of Peru to get the show made. And four of them were volunteers from Wellspring who went on to the orphanage. And then the other 15 were our traveling entourage. So we had two camera guys, two sound guys, one girl who was, she drove a support truck and just ran GoPro cameras, two producers, and then we had two other drivers that their job was hydration, bags, luggage, you know, nutrition. Brandon, making sure everybody's got to keep their blood sugar up. You've got to keep a lot of calories in. You've got to stay hydrated. You can't ride across the desert and not have the right food and drink. And then we had five riders, myself being one, three cast members, and a support rider. He's a BMW-trained instructor from the facility that we trained at. Who was there? He rode at the back with a microphone in his helmet, and I rode at the front. We had a communication device. So pretty much the whole way across Peru, he and I would be talking to each other, how they were doing, if someone had fallen, if I was going too fast, if he thought we were pushing them too hard, or if he thought we could just, I call them my eyes and ears in the rear. So without having to turn my head to look at the guys, I could see them in my mirror. I had a ongoing dialogue to what they were doing.
So about how many hours did you ride on this trip when you went to Peru?
Well, most days we didn't really get rolling. Moving that many people is quite the logistical nightmare because you imagine everybody's got luggage. You think about it for cameras. They've got to have batteries and lenses and tripods and the audio guys have to have all their stuff. Everybody had to be mic'd up the whole time. So it was quite the machine to get moving. So probably in pure riding terms, the whole trip was only about 1,700 kilometers. But they were long days because once you put your gear on and got on the bike, it could be 8, 10, 12 hours before you were getting off at the other end.
Wow. You know, we're going to take a short break, and when we come back, I want to talk more about you and your history with the motorcycles, okay?
Wouldn't be safe to keep your distance until there's
no secret that will make you smile.
Why do sources say that chicken soup has proven
has found their way out of this
Getting closer to nature can get you closer to your family. Go to discovertheforest.org.
When you throw away money on wasted electricity, you're throwing away everything you could have bought with it. Saving energy saves you money.
Welcome back to Betty. I'm your host, Cynthia Thompson. I'm here with Neil, and he is sharing his experience of creating a reality show about riding a motorcycle in Peru with some people that have probably never ridden a motorcycle before.
They'd all ridden before?
Oh, they had.
They just hadn't ridden in such an extreme environment as Peru.
So let me ask you a couple questions about motorcycles. What is your favorite one to ride? Because there are so many, just like cars. They have different models, different companies make some, and what is your favorite one?
The favorite one is the one I'm riding at the moment. And whatever I'm on is my favorite.
Oh!
In my career, I've ridden just about every type of motorcycle imaginable.
Really?
And I've tested everything from a 1936 Harley Davidson where you had to press the clutch with your foot and shift with your hand, and everything was all back to front and no suspension. It probably went about 50 miles an hour. And then I've ridden motorcycles with turbochargers that can go 250 miles an hour.
250 miles
per
hour?
They go more than that now.
Oh, really?
I actually have a fellow called me the other day, and he said, do you want to go? He wants me to go and try and go 250 miles an hour on a motorcycle on October the 19th. So I said, well, if I'm not busy, that'd be not a bad idea, right?
You're not afraid? That's really fast.
I'm afraid of not doing it. But, and I also rode a world championship winning motorcycle. It was valued at over $1 million. And that was a bit nerve-wracking.
Why is that?
It's capable of doing 220 miles an hour. It can go 0 to 100 faster than a Formula One motor car. And it belonged to the most famous world champion in the world. And it was valued at $1 million. So if you messed up and crashed it, they would not be happy with you.
Speaking of crashes, you've been riding since you were 14 years old.
Correct.
How many crashes have you had? Or do you know the number?
No, it's impossible to remember. Impossible. I maybe could narrow it down to ones that have broken bones, but even that's getting hard to remember now.
And you still ride?
Yes, yes. Why would you not?
I don't know. I don't think I could do it. If I were to fall off, I don't think I could get back on again. But then this is our men's show today.
Correct.
And men love motorcycles, but ladies do too.
Yeah, my life and career on motorcycles is not typical to most cyclists. I test motorcycles, so I'm at the extreme edge of what they can do a lot. I've ridden in 45 countries around the world, so I've been in some very extreme conditions. And stuff goes wrong sometimes. So training accidents, I've cracked a few bones here on training accidents. It was very unlucky during a test early in my career. There was a malfunction with the bike at about 130 miles an hour, and it something drug on the floor and spat me off. So I hit the floor at about 125 miles an hour, and that did a lot of damage. And it wasn't my fault, but it doesn't matter when you're on the floor, who's counting.
Is there any such thing as a super bike?
Yes, the big bikes are called super bikes.
Oh,
absolutely.
Really?
That's what they call them, yeah.
And so what makes them a super bike?
The size and the power.
Uh-huh.
So the biggest, most powerful bikes are called super bikes.
And you've ridden one of those, right?
Oh, many of them, yes. Many of them. And they even in stock trim, you can probably go about 188 miles an hour on one of those. So it'd be great for you to go home, beat the traffic.
You can pretty much fly over the traffic,
exactly.
Huh? You had mentioned before that there's training involved in riding motorcycles. What kind of training do you provide?
Well, I've got to beat a little bit of a drum here. In America, 4 times more people die or get badly injured in motorcycles than they do in Europe.
Why is that?
There's no training here in this country. You can take training if you want. There's a thing called the Motorcycle Safety Foundation course, which will put you through training and give you your license. Very elementary, but it's better than nothing. But the majority of people, they can go and get a permit, take a written test, on the computer like you're at the DMV, and they can go and get any motorcycle they want without any training whatsoever. And we have 4 times more fatalities. Our accident rate is horrible compared to Europe. Now, in Europe, you can't do that. You have to train. You have to go through. You're limited to the bike size you can ride, how long you can ride it, and the training you have to be able to get on the road. So I am absolutely all about training. And that is why one of the features of Neil Bailey Rides, when you watch it, whether you take it away from the thing, is that the riders had to train. They had to be qualified to do it. We had to watch them. They had to do, you'll see, quite vigorous drills. I mean, they crashed and got hurt in the training process. But I would rather they had crashed and suffered minor injury on a small dirt bike than had something very serious in Peru.
Yes.
Because when we were in Peru, and you'll see there are a number of crashes, thankfully quite low speed, no great injury. But there's a lot of situations where their skill needed to be very high. And the only way to get that is training. So it's something that I said, I mean, I've got to beat my drum a little bit here. We're in remiss in this country where we don't give enough training. And then, of course, somebody will go out, they'll buy the wrong bike, they'll get hurt, and people think motorcycling is dangerous. They think motorcycle is a problem. The problem is the rider didn't take the training. And then we have a very strange mindset in this country. Nobody thinks there's anything dangerous about driving in a car. Tens of thousands of people die every year in automobile accidents. You can't go down the road without seeing a car crash. That's pretty dangerous to me, but no one thinks it's dangerous. So hopefully the show will show the need for training and how these, you know, our cast members took the training and then safely made it through Peru.
So this is your pilot for your reality show. What do you see in the future for your show?
This, yeah, this is a pilot series of 3 hours. I would really like to continue this all over the world, where we pick a continent and we go and we identify an orphanage or a place of need. And each series would take a new group of people on this adventure and let them experience the world and the culture and the adventure and the travel. But at the end of it, they're giving something back. It's not just a trophy on the wall to say, I went here. They're helping those that are in need. And I really hope it'll be a great influence to the viewer to get an opportunity to see the world. We can show what a beautiful place this is. And I think when you look and you see the need that exists in other countries from this perspective, maybe it'll just help us understand that we've got it pretty lucky here.
One last question for you. Where's your favorite place to ride? Because I understand you've been to many countries. Is that another tough question?
That's a really tough question. I love riding in Peru. There's something very, very magical about Peru to me. It's a beautiful country. The people are really beautiful. I love riding in Europe, the Alps, the Dolomites. The roads are just perfect. If you like switchbacks and twisting back and forward. Probably some of the best motorcycle roads that we have in the country or in the world are right here in our back doorstep. The Blue Ridge Parkway in Western North Carolina. I would say that's probably some of the best motorcycling you could find anywhere in the world. So North Carolina is probably one of the best states that you could live in the world for motorcycling.
One thing, you bought some footage for us to look at. Let's take a look at your footage. And then we'll talk about this, okay?
Perfect.
Today, Neil returns to Peru for a 3,000-kilometer adventure motorcycle journey with three other riders to raise awareness for the abandoned children of Moquegua.
Hey, Neil Bailey here, on location in Moquegua, Peru. We're in the southeast region of Peru. We're in the desert. This is actually an oasis. We're here at Hogar Belen. I'm here with my little friend Kathleen. She's one of the children that live here. Now, these are the abandoned children of Moquegua. They have no parents. They have no families. And they're here at Moquegua. This is where they live. We've been on an adventure motorcycle ride. You see, we're riding XR 600s. I'm riding with a group of friends. We started in Lima. We made our way up through Abancay. We went to the ancient city of Cusco. We took a day trip out to see Machu Picchu, which is the lost city of the Incas. And then we came across the Altiplano here to the orphanage. And we're riding to raise awareness for the abandoned children of Moquegua. So come with us on this adventure and help us raise some money to support these children.
Let's go, brother. Every road that I've taken can never be mistaken for the one that now is under my feet.
I cannot believe that you all rode your motorcycles there. The terrain was not even or anything.
Oh, and no, thick sand,
yeah,
and freezing cold fog, uh-huh, and cars, and some of those trucks. I mean, they were all on the wrong side of the road.
Uh-huh.
And so, you notice how close we're passing, and
yes,
horns honking, and it's a wild place to ride.
Uh-huh, yeah, but a fun place to ride.
It's tremendous, yeah.
Uh-huh.
And there seems to be no speed limits. You can ride on the sidewalk, you can go on any side of the road, you can pass on the inside. I mean, you can pull wheelies past policemen. I've tested it a couple of times. I mean, you can just, there's no rules.
Uh-huh.
It's just like, it's like the Wild West. You get on your bike and
just go for
just
it.
Just go.
Read to a child today and spark a lifetime of ambition.
Kitchen surfaces, utensils, and hands with soapy water. 1 in 6 Americans will get sick from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
What's really interesting about the show is it's produced here in Charlotte. And I had done a television show before, and it didn't go deep enough for me. I wanted more. I was raising money for these kids in Peru, and I was doing this, not fluff television, but it was just myself and my friends riding around on expensive bikes and staying in nice hotels, which is great, and people really enjoyed it, and I think it gave them an opportunity to see parts of Europe and say, I'd like to do that, and how great you can go and travel.
Uh-huh.
So when I decided I wanted to do this show, I had various ideas about how I was going to get it done and how I was going to get it pitched. Well, quite by chance, my young friend Brandon, who you'll see in the television show, he has been really helpful. We've worked together, trained together. He's a chef with a background in nutrition, so he did a lot of diet and exercise programming for me, because I've been pretty busted up crashing, as you can imagine, and I have rods and pins and snapped bits and broken bits.
Ooh.
So I'm quite often rehabbing some injury.
Uh-huh.
So he got very involved with that. And he wrote an article about me in a small fitness magazine about how his training program, what he was feeding me. Yeah, I think I lost 20 pounds in weight and gained a lot of endurance and just, you know, overall fitter and healthier, mm-hmm, for his plan. And a lady called Linda Midget, her husband bought the magazine home and said, I've found your new TV show. Well, she happens to be an Emmy award-winning television producer who lives here in Charlotte.
Really?
Yeah, she ran Gangland for History Channel.
Uh-huh.
She was the producer, so she's one of History Channel's most successful TV producers. She's won Emmys, she's done Discovery, National Geographic, History, daytime soap operas.
Uh-huh.
So she's actually the real deal in television.
She lives here in Charlotte?
But she lives here in Charlotte. And we went out to dinner one evening, like we're doing, and having a chat, and 4.5 hours later, we decided we were in business together and,
uh-huh,
we were going to make the show.
Uh-huh.
And it's been game on ever since. And it's not been an easy thing to do.
Uh-huh.
The American television world is not super happy about the idea of people riding around to help others in foreign countries.
Really?
No, I think we went conservatively 12 or 13 network rejections.
Were they hoping that you would help people here in America instead of the foreign countries?
I don't know. It's a good question. I mean, we had everything. We were told we were too earnest, too soft, too fluffy, too intelligent. I mean, it was quite a lot of different reasons. And
well, if you think about reality TV, what sales
well, I know.
Is
I mean,
the
Snooki,
drama.
Snooki's,
yeah.
Snooki's putting a load of laundry in tonight.
Uh-huh.
That's great TV.
Yeah.
I mean, Kim Kardashian's buying a new ring. I mean, who doesn't want to be tuning in for that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, imagine riding adventure motorcycles in beautiful countries around the world and raising money for kids and educating people. Yeah, I mean, I can't imagine why anyone would want to watch that.
Well, hopefully you will change the way people look at reality
TV.
Well,
we hope so. I mean, this is a bold step. I mean, I don't think we have anything really too much like this on television at the moment.
Uh-huh.
And as Linda says, it's a reality TV show with a heart. There's a purpose to the journey. We want people to change. We want the viewers to change. And we want people to have something that's got more value. I mean, how many times do you hear, I mean, you make television, people say, oh, the stuff on television is just crap these days. Yeah, it's like a car crash on the highway. Everybody's tuning in and watching it. I mean, why do we care about these people?
You know, but
arguing and fighting, and I mean, that's not how life is. I mean, you're supposed to be there to help people, aren't you?
So that they can be a better you, right?
That's what you really hope, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think we've taken a bold step. I think if you would ask me what would be my ideal for the show, is that they go, wow, this is new, this is great, and people will really like it.
Uh-huh.
And maybe people would say, let's go make a TV show about canoeing down rivers in the world, raising money for people, or bicycling across countries, or the whole idea of just doing things. Why not do something you're passionate about and use it to help others? I mean, I don't know what the downside of that is.
And I think you're on to something, too.
Well,
and you know what,
thank
Neil?
You.
I want you to come back on my show so that we can talk about this organization where you help the orphans, okay?
Perfect, yes.
And I want to thank you for joining me today.
Well, thank
you. I've learned so much about motorcycles.
I know. Next thing, we'll have to take you on a motorcycle next.
We'll see about that. Thank each and every one of you for watching The Better You, and I hope you learned something about motorcycles and all the wonderful things that Neil is doing for the orphans out there. And stay tuned to A Better You every Wednesday night at 6 p.m. here on Public Access 21.